If you want to succeed and get ahead, the name of the game is adding value. That could be value to your customers or to your organization. As a dev, how do you add value? Well, it's probably in creating those new products and features that people want, or maybe you found a bug and now you can get that fixed. As an ops person, it's different. We want to make sure that the lights stay on. We want to make sure that things are backed up and protected and that all of the performance is what it should be. Those are all very different ways of adding value, and sometimes this can put the devs and ops against each other. How can we prevent this from happening? The DevOps Cycle is here to help.
I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy.
Welcome to Project Awesome New Thing. A project commitments have been made to our business, and we're ready to ship in 1 month. Denny the dev will be our developer, and Guy the ops guy will support us in production. So Denny, how long will it take to write this magnificent new code?
Yeah, no problem, man. It should be like, I don't know, 3 weeks.
Oh,
it's gonna
perfect.
Be great, man. It's gonna be great. Excuse me, Denny, did you just say 3 weeks? So we're only gonna have 1 week to do testing and get the code into production? That is not gonna work because our testing cycle before moving anything into prod is 2 weeks.
Well, I'm sorry, Guy, but the business is already committed to shipping in 1 month. We'll just all have to tighten our belts and knuckle down and get things done on time. Are you sure you need all those testing steps? You are, after all, the expert.
Okay, Manny, which of those testing procedures do you suggest we skip? Hey, it don't bother me. My code is solid. I tested it myself. Really, Denny? And just where do you test your code? On my laptop or when it's already in prod, man. I test on the fly.
Wait, I'm sorry. You test your code in production? Why do we even have a testing environment?
What? How long have we had a test environment? That sounds like a great idea.
Dude, are you kidding me? Nobody uses that test environment. It's like 100 years old. It doesn't even match my specs or nothing.
We built the test and the prod environment at the same time. They were built identically and we maintain it, so it's just like production.
Oops. Guess that's why you can't get my awesomeness code working in prod either. Man, you don't know how to build anything right. I'm just gonna have to do it myself. I'll build some servers and, you know, it's gonna be awesome. I don't even need you.
And just how are you gonna do that, Denny? After the last time you pushed your awesome code to the database while we were in the middle of doing a SAN upgrade because you didn't follow change management, we took your rights away.
Man, I don't know. I'm gonna do what I gotta do. Maybe I'll spin up a VM or two in AWS or something.
So if you did that, Denny, you could build the code and test it?
Totally, man. It's gonna be awesome. This guy's just holding up the show.
Wait, no, that's even worse. It won't look our environment on-prem or in the cloud. It's not even your laptop.
Hey, man, the world wants my awesome code. And if you won't work with me to get it done, I'll just do it myself.
Well, this has been a tremendous meeting. I will let the business know that they can expect the product to ship on time in 1 month. Denny will have 3 weeks to write all of that code and test it, and then Guy will have 1 week to get the code into production. That sounds reasonable. Great meeting, everyone. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Wow, that was rough, but obviously it was just an exaggeration, and hopefully you've never been any one of those people in those meetings. So we had three people here. We had Manny the manager, Denny the dev, and Guy the ops guy, and all of them had their own priorities. Manny only cared about the ship date on the calendar because that was his responsibility to the business. Denny only cared about writing the code because that's his area of responsibility, and it didn't matter how that code got into production or how much time he gave anybody else in the schedule. And then the ops guy saw the entire thing as just a big inconvenience and acted as a blocker to everything and didn't offer any real solutions in working together. And he's just annoyed because people don't follow all the processes that he's responsible for, and he thinks nobody else cares. They're all working toward the same goal of getting this awesome new thing into production, making the customers happier, making the business succeed. That's what their focus should be, working together. And this is where the DevOps cycle comes in. Now, have you ever seen this symbol? That's the symbol for infinity. It is a loop that never ends and just keeps on going forever and ever and ever. That's the DevOps cycle. So let's do some of this magic. So here's the cycle: plan, code, build, test, release, deploy, operate, monitor, and then it goes back again. So our first step is to plan. Everything begins with a plan. You have to know the end from the beginning if you want to succeed. In the case of Azure, we're focused on infrastructure as code, but we still need to know what the point of what we're building is. The next step is to code. This is where the dev would go out and actually build the code according to the plan to meet the goal. Now, in the case of infrastructure as code, you ops people may end up actually filling the role of dev because you may be building the infrastructure as code through our ARM templates, which we're going to be working on in a few minutes. So in the build phase, we're taking that code and we want to create something called an MVP. This is a minimal viable product. So this may be like building a car, like that one. When you're building a car and you want an MVP of a car, this could be the engine, the frames, and the wheels. You don't need paint, you don't need windows, and you don't need spinning rims. All that comes later. Those are features. And the next step in the process is to test. This is where we're going to test that MVP. Does it do what we think it does? So in the release, this is where you're doing code promotion from environment to environment and make sure that they have the processes, the rights, and that everything works as expected before handing it off to ops. Or this could be where you hand off to ops and they're gonna do that test in the non-prod environment before it gets pushed into production to make sure that everything works as you've told them it should. And then we come to deploy, and this is definitely an ops role. This is where we're pushing the code into production. Everything that they have delivered should just work. If it doesn't, something was missed in a prior step. So now that we've got the code in production, it needs to run. It needs to be operated. And this is where the code lives in that production environment, and we want to be sure that it is doing what it's supposed to do. So how do we do that? That's the next step, which is to monitor. In monitoring, we want to check its performance. Is it eating up too much resources and it's not working as advertised? We want to be sure that it's got the right amount of uptime, downtime, patch management, security, all of that stuff. We want it to be monitored and verify that it's working as it should. If not, then we can introduce those things as issues into the plan phase, okay? And then we repeat the cycle all over again. Everyone has to work together. And if the ops people don't succeed, the devs don't either. And maybe you've heard it said before that if a dev has to carry the pager, they're going to write better code.
If you want to master the Azure cloud, you can start right now by clicking the subscribe button and the notification bell so you don't miss anything.
Hey, y'all, welcome back to Denny's Masterclass in ARM Templates. Today, we're covering two things, the ARM VS Code extension and parameters. So over on the top left, we're going to click to add a new folder. We're going to build ourselves a workspace. We're going to name that DevOps. And then we're going to click and add a new file. And this is going to be called azuredeploy.json. And in there, we're going to type ARM. And then you're going to get this box. And we're going to click on the very first one, ARM with the exclamation point. And now we've got our ARM outline all set up without having to type anything else. It's awesome. Let's go over here on the left to the resources and click a plus. And then in the box at the top, we're going to type virtual network. And then boom! There's virtual network code, all done for you without you having to know nothing. All right, so let's go up to the top to the terminal. And we're gonna do a deployment. But first we gotta sign in to Azure, which last time we did with the Connect-AZ account. We still need that, but I wanna automate it. So we're gonna do this instead. We're gonna do a get credentials command from PowerShell, pass it our username, give it our password. We're gonna sign in automatically and don't be trying to steal my password. So now let's run the Connect-AZ account, pass it our creds. We are signed in to Azure and ready to go. So let's type our deployment command, new AZ resource group deployment, give it a name, give it our template file, and then hit enter. And as soon as we do, it's gonna build that template and we're gonna go up to Azure and check it out. And there it is, all done. Boom, ARM code is awesome. Now, we want to make this a little more interesting. So let's go back and add a parameter. So we're going to go to the parameters section and put in the double quotes. And when we do, it's going to prompt us to add a new parameter. And you do, and then it's going to fill all that information for you, but you still have to give it a special name. So we're going to call that virtual network name, which means we have to replace our virtual network's existing name with a parameter. So we're going to go down and we're going to type in the square bracket, just like that. And then we're going to get a whole list of functions. And there's a whole lot of them. We'll come back to all that later. Right now, we just want parameters, which is a function. And then we give it the parentheses, and then it's going to ask us to select which parameter we want to use, and we want our virtual network name. And now that we got our virtual network name, let's do another deployment. All right, and then we go and run that deployment again. This time, it's going to prompt us to enter a virtual network name. And we're going to go typey-typey on that, and then we're going to do the deployment. It's up in Azure, so let's go check it out. We go to the deployment again, click on DevOps, and then there it is. We go to inputs. There is our parameter, which also means that we now have a parameters file that we can get out of the Azure portal. So let's click over there and do some of that. Copy that, go back to VS Code. Now we're going to make a new file, and this is going to be azuredeploy.parameters.json, and then paste all the code. Now, this is just a JSON file. This is not working yet with the ARM extensions that are here. So we want to change our language over in the corner, and then we'll click on the box up top, change that to Azure Resource Manager template. And now we want to link the two together. So we'll go back to our template, click where it says to select the parameters file, and that gives you a drop-down box. Pick your parameters file, and now they are linked together, which you can tell because it has filled in the name of our virtual network. So let's create another parameter. Between all the different parameters, we need a comma, and then we'll do the same thing. We'll put it into quotes, select our new parameter, give it a name, and this one is going to be for a subnet. So we'll just rename this to be subnet name -1, which means we got to go down to the subnet section, find that thing, and then do the square bracket, type in parameter, give it the parentheses, select the subnet 1 parameter, and we are good to go. So let's do another deployment. We'll go back to the terminal, set it all up again to run the same thing, but this time we are going to add -template parameter file and give it our azuredeploy.parameter.json file. Hit enter, but look, it did not ask us for a virtual network name. Why? Because it's in the parameters file, man. So now we'll type in the name of the subnet, do the deployment, go back to Azure, and there it is, and we have another input, which means we can capture that from the parameters file and do the same thing we just did. Let's write a parameter directly, and we'll type it in this time. New parameter into quotes, subnet name -2, and then look at that. Now it's set it all up. So we can do a value, and that's gonna be what the parameter equals. And we get rid of them comments because we don't need that. Don't hurt nothing, but we just don't need it. Then we'll go back and do another deployment, and then there it is. Now we got 3 parameters, and you just keep doing this all day long and replace everything you want with parameters, and then that'll make it all kind of easy to make this template do something and then deploy it again, and you get a whole nother something else. So that's parameters, and that's some of the things about working with the ARM templates. And I know I went kind of fast with all that, but you know, I expect you guys to be sharp, man. I mean, you're trying to be in the dev world now, so you know, keep up. Oh, thanks, Denny. Subtle as always, appreciate that. And if you've been appreciating our content, please do click on that subscribe button down below. I have it on good authority that if you don't do that, that somebody somewhere will duct tape a small puppy to a small kitten, and then they'll just run in circles with each other until they both pass out from exhaustion. And you don't want that to happen. Save a puppy or a kitten today, as well as click the thumbs up if you've been enjoying this series on DevOps. These skits don't make themselves, so I need comments from you on what you want to see in an upcoming video. That always helps me out. And if you want to keep the learning going, over on the top, we've got our latest video, and at the bottom, one from the overlords at YouTube, and you definitely don't want to miss those. Thanks for joining us for today's video, and we will see you in the next one. Happy learning.